A man without ethics is a wild beast loosened upon this world. This was said by famous French philosopher Albert Camus. With this thought, I welcome you all to Diadme. Today we have brought something different for you, wherein in this orientation lecture, we will discuss our course offering, of course, but we shall also tell you how to score high marks in ethics paper and how to increase your marks in UPSC GS paper 4. This knowledge, which I am just going to present you, has come from my own experience of giving UPSC and state level examinations, and after talking with several selected people and after also analyzing topper copies. So let's move ahead. Overall preparation tip. Here I would like to tell you that there are few basic things which we need to complete before we can even think to improve, because there are many times that many good students will do these things. That possibility is there. All right. So we have to cover these basic things, and then how to improve, we'll just discuss. So first of all, you have to know the syllabus by heart so that you can interlink. This is a key word. Just a second. Interlink. And interlink what? So that you can interlink the syllabus of GS paper 4 with other GS papers like GS 1, 2 and 3, and even optional. So if you interlink, you can extract more examples. You can extract more case studies, which you can quote in your answer. We'll see that how to do all this. Then you have to remember the values. Values means what we are going to discuss. Value basically tells your preference, what you like, what you don't like. All right. So you have to remember the values and connection. How value 1 is linked with value 2. Okay. What benefit else which comes from it is you can substantiate your answer. You can justify your answer. So once you read the syllabus properly, you will remember the values which are mentioned in the syllabus, and then you will use them with examples in your answers. Okay. So this is a general preparation tip which we will focus on. And after this, we'll see that how granular we can go, basically how deep we can go and how stepwise we can go. All right. And this, I'm not just going to tell you, I'm going to show you by solving two questions in front of you. All right. So third point, let's discuss before moving forward, that where do these examples come from? Like I just said, it will come from GS papers also. And GS paper, I mean 1, 2 and 3. Here, you will also have to make new examples for GS paper 4. All right. Basically, in GS 3, if we take example of female labor force participation rate in the economy, if we talk about this, we have facts and figure related to it. All right. So that can be used in GS paper 3 and can be used for women issues. Okay, in GS paper 1 and 2. Okay, and now how you use it, that depends on you. But I'm just saying that how an example can be used. Okay, so here you have to collect separate examples unit wise. Unit 1 to 7 we have, and we also have case studies. We'll discuss about case studies later, but overall preparation tip is this only. Remember the syllabus, remember the values, find examples related to the syllabus, and then use it in your answers. That's it. And this is how we'll help you also. All right. So for example, you can take examples from your real life, which I'm going to show you how I did it myself, you know, and you can take examples from your own personal life also. Okay. This is real life examples from other people's lives, and you can take out examples from your own life, what you have felt. How you can do this, I also will going to tell you. The way to do this is once you read one chapter, okay, after I teach you one chapter, what you can do is you can relate it to your own life. Okay, and then after your notes, you can just write them down chapter wise. That's it. And when you revise it, you will revise the examples also, and then it creates more chances for you to remember in it examination. All right, let's move forward. Okay, here I'm going to show you some examples which I personally took from newspapers or my online reading. Okay, so in Japanese, they believe that students should clean the school themselves. Why? Because it teaches them responsibility. Okay, and when every student is doing it, it creates equality. You can guess how responsibility is fostered, that they are responsible for cleaning their own mess. And when every student is doing it, you get equality. Like in India, as you know, caste system exists everywhere. So many times students from backward classes are made to sit on the floor, right? So this thing is not prevalent over there. Okay. Next example, like this was a big news. So when the IS officer took charge, okay, and cleaned basically from Indore the garbage, okay, there were huge photos that huge mounds, basically mountains, pahad jo the, they were removed, literally gone. Okay, so this is commitment to civil service, right? Or you can say innovativeness, because there must be IS officer before him or her also. Okay, so this person was more innovative than the previous IS officers. Okay, I'm not denigrating anybody, I'm just saying that he was more innovative, that's all. Okay, this also can be quoted example of quality service delivery, which is a topic in our syllabus. All right, so this I extracted from a newspaper which I read. It's called Speaking Tree. Okay, it focuses on that, it tells you that just because something is economically advancing, it is not as the same thing as human progressing. Okay, so basically it says that economic advance is not the same thing as human progress. What do you mean, or what do you understand by this? Can you think? Okay, so I'll tell you that it is related to value development in the human beings. Again, you see mention of the term value. So this is very important. You have to understand ethical approach and moral approach through values. We will see that in our lectures. All right. So such images help you become a better learner, you know, because as humans, you might have observed also that we are visual learners. When we are small, we are taught A for apple, B for ball by showing words also, but showing the pictures. All right. Last thing, just for an example, it's about justice. Okay. So when you read about justice in my class, when you will read about it, it is a end value. Okay. That we should lead, our decisions should lead to justice, more justice in the society. Okay. So while browsing internet, I found this while Googling, simple Googling. I did not do anything out of the ordinary. I just Googled justice and I found this while preparing. So I just kept it. So these are visual learners. See, once you see that these hands are holding each other, right? So it tells you about togetherness, brotherhood, esprit de corps. Okay. So all these things like justice is being together. Okay. Rather than basically being separate. All right. Okay. One more point. Here I would like to tell you that we will be providing many such examples to you. Okay, but I would like to tell you that, like I told you before also, that if you can take out examples from your own life, that will help you stand out from the rest of the crowd. Because examiner is sort of, you know, bored by reading just bookish examples which are written in many books. And that is not fault of anyone. As student, what will you do? You will attend courses and you will, you know, read books. But to stand out, to have your content different than others, what you can do? You see, basically this is a general studies paper. You're not going to go and read PhD level books wherein a content would be different. All right, so what will you do? You can relate that thing with your own life. Okay, so that will make the answer more personal. And something different, let's just say in like there are 6 case studies, and in 2 to 3 case studies you write something different, you'll get 1 or 2 marks extra, right? And in part A, in theory questions, when you write something and you write something from your personal life, that will differentiate your answer again. Okay, so that is how you increase, and that is our aim. We will provide you examples, we will also teach you how to think about the examples. So that is our orientation. And I'm not just saying this, I'll show you the question also. Okay, how we solve it. Okay, so after the lecture, you can do one thing. After every lecture, just sit for 5-10 minutes and think about how you can relate today's lecture with your life. Okay, have you faced same issues in your life or not? Have any one of your friends faced some issues? If you're working, you will have a lot of examples when we read about corporate governance, when we read about sexual harassment at workplace. You might have heard about some cases. So people who are working would have more examples. Okay, but this is not to say that people who are just young or who are in college, they are at a disadvantage. No. What you can do is, if you can relate it with your life, very good. Okay, that's the main point. It doesn't matter if somebody is working or not. I'm just saying they will have more examples, not good examples or better examples. Please remember that. There is also something called relevant examples, relevant quotes. We'll see about that. So point is to be relevant. Find relevant. That is why I said that you have to find the example in your own life after the lecture is over. Okay. So focus on this. All right. Okay. Let's move to the next part. Herein we'll see, before the scene, now we are coming to the actual practical part, and here we'll see before answering the actual question, we'll see how to approach a question. Please remember that this is a model way to do it, which has been collected after a lot of experience, but there is nothing perfect. Okay, every examiner is different, every student is different, but yes, this is a general approach which you can follow. Okay, but as we in our course, we have some answer writing sessions, so we will tell you how to approach different questions also. All right, so there are 3 parts basically. There is define, there is use, there is relate. Let's see them. Okay, define, use, and relate. Now you'll ask, what do I define and where do I define, right? So you define the concept which is asked in the question. And where do you define? In the introduction itself. And why? Why to define over there? Because it's the quickest way to start an answer. You know, people who have written mains will agree with me here that sometimes starting the answer is the most difficult part. You are very confused. And in main examination, we don't have much time to think. Okay, we have in barely enough time to read the question twice, you know. So the quickest way of starting the answer is introduction. All right, so where to define, what to define, you have got it, and why to define also. All right, so in main examination, do not get stuck. And what to do about that? Start the definition of the concept in the intro itself. All right, so defining the concept in the intro is a kickstart for you. Okay, now you have to use what? In my opinion, you should use examples and diagrams. Wherever, please remember these 2 things, wherever relevant, and if you have time crunch. Okay, so what type of diagrams? I'll show you. My own approach to doing ethics is through diagrams, lot of diagrams. Although yes, there are some things which you will write in the lectures also, but mostly when I teach you something, it will be through diagrams. Okay, because as I said earlier, we are visual learners. Okay, there is one more thing, flowcharts. you can also use them, okay, to save time basically, right, and to stand out. My intention, all right, to providing you this service is to make you stand out from other people, okay, and I'll keep sprinkling such tips during the course also, okay. All right, now coming to the third thing, okay, you relate with what, okay, you relate with GS paper 1, 2, and 3. You will read about history, polity, okay, economic, geography. Here you will read a lot of examples. Like in history, you will read about Raja Ram Mohan Roy. You will read about Mahatma Gandhi. Okay, and so on. You will read about Bhagat Singh. Okay, such examples. Also world history, Hitler, Napoleon. Okay, various US presidents. Okay, Winston Churchill also from the British side. All right, so polity. Okay, various examples from self-help groups. Okay, economy, how some startup might have, came out of unlikeliest of places, like some village wherein there is no hope, and some person built a successful business out of it. There is an example of a lady who is tribal. She started handicraft company and she has a turnover of approximately 30 lakhs right now. Okay, but she also went through a lot of trouble and failures. Okay, so that is some example. So we'll have such examples wherever relevant. Okay, so when you relate your basically ethical question in GS4 with examples from GS1, 2, 3, this will also make your answer, again like I said, stand out. Okay, all right, so let's move on to, after, since we have discussed the approach, okay, now we will see it practically how it is done. All right, okay, so let's go straight away to the question. All right, so for your benefit, I'm just going to read it out once. Okay, critically analyze the significance of emotional intelligence for the civil servants in ensuring effective delivery of their administrative duties. Okay, so first of always try to identify the keyword. Keyword is critically analyze. Okay, and emotional intelligence for civil servants, obviously, in effective delivery. That is the main point. Okay, how emotional intelligence will help, basically, that is the question. Okay, so we have searched for the keywords. Okay, now let's go to the previous slide just for 1 second. You have to define, use, and relate. Okay, now using this approach, I'm going to solve this question for you. Okay, now why I chose basically emotional intelligence topic, because it is extremely important, and as you go on further in your career and as you progress, you will realize how important it is. And if you disagree with me right now, then after my EI lecture, I hope you will agree with me. Okay, so let's have a discussion on the question itself. All right, so here I would like to give you a rough outline. Okay, so like I said, define, okay, use examples, you can see that, and you have to relate also. Yeah, here, okay, so first of all, we will write the definition of emotional intelligence, right? It basically means that you have to manage your own emotions and others' emotions. That is, it will basically create self and social awareness. I'll show you by a diagram how it does that, right? So like, basically, let's take an example. You know, some people get moody sometimes, okay? So if they are aware of that, okay? So if they are aware of their moodiness, they will able to handle or at least tell other people that, you know, I'm moody, please, you know, for a while, stay away from me. Now, there are many people who know that they can't tolerate liars. All right, so this is also emotional intelligence. Basically, knowing about yourself and then understanding others and then handling these emotions. Okay, so basically what happens is, once you know yourself, it gives you confidence. We'll see, there is a very interesting diagram, we'll see. I'm just trying to explain you right now the approach. Okay, and also if you are not good in GS paper 2, let's say, it's just an example. Okay, in general studies paper 2, you are not good. Okay, so what you will do? You will prepare harder. Okay, then you might improve. Okay, then this gives you confidence. So that is how you relate things. Okay, that is how you understand things, by relating, not by mugging up, by relating. Because why this is so important, I have kept relate as a keyword, because in UPSC examinations, there are questions which you won't know. You won't know some questions. You have to go there and attempt it in the exam right there. So for that, you need to be able to relate the concept given with life. And you don't have to do this on your own. We are going to teach you. We are going to tell you how to understand a question. We'll have special sessions on that. All right, so moving forward. So as I said, if you're not good in one paper, you prepare for it, you focus more on it. Okay, then you will improve. Okay, then your confidence will improve. So basically what happened? You used your emotional intelligence to increase your confidence. So this is an example. Although I understand this might feel very simple to you, but that is how we should do things. We have to, you know, keep it simple, silly. There is a informal quote going on that keep it simple, silly. Okay. So keeping things simple is quite hard. So relate with your life, relate with GS knowledge, and half of your work is done. Okay. All right. So first of all, we are going to define emotional intelligence. So basically, emotional intelligence is being intelligent about emotions, right? By perceiving them. Okay, by evaluating them, and by regulating and controlling them. Okay, so this is my own informal, basically a definition, which I have made by reading from various topics. All right, so you can just mug it up. So just to recap, emotional intelligence is being intelligent about emotions by perceiving, evaluating, regulating, and controlling them. And it's just not about your own emotions, but about other emotions as well. It's basically about using the emotions effectively. All right. Now let's see a diagram. It's a very interesting diagram. Okay. You have here your self, then social. Okay. Now, basically your own emotions and emotions outside your own. Okay, just give me a second till I complete this. Now, if you are self-aware, okay, and you can recognize the emotions that you have, okay, and then once you recognize, you can regulate them. Okay, now we'll see what happens because of this. Okay, if you are self-aware plus you recognize, what you end up with is confidence. Like I just told you before, that if you work on your weakness, okay, carefully, and you improve, what you will gain is confidence that yes, I can improve. Yes, I can do things. Okay, that gives you a little bit of, or it increases your stability. And which stability? Not physical, but emotional. Sorry for writing it in the short form, space is less. So it gives you emotional stability because you will not be scared by defeats. All right, but best of all, you learn how to assess yourself. This is very important. So that's how you improve. So if you are self-aware and you recognize those things, your confidence increases, your stability increases, you can you get the ability to assess yourself. All right, let's move on to the next column. If you are socially aware of emotions, okay, and then you recognize them, your interpersonal relationships improve. All right, your social network improves. You will know more people will like you. Okay, also your sensitivity increases. What does that mean? Can you guess? See, if you can recognize their emotions, you become more sensitive to them, right? Like if a woman, let's say you're an IPS officer or any police officer, and a lady comes to you, right, on your residence, and she's basically in trouble or she's feeling that somebody's stalking her. So what do? Will you say, ma'am, it's too late, please come tomorrow or come to the office? No, right? That's not being sensitive to the needs of the person at that moment. Okay, so being sensitive and recognizing others' emotions makes you sensitive and basically a better civil servant. Okay, now quickly coming on to the next part, if you can manage yourself or basically your emotions, right? So what will happen? Think anything. So if you manage these emotions, you will be able to motivate yourself. Like let's say after a lot of, you know, let's just relate with UPSC examinations. There are many people who are not able to make it, but they're able to make it in their next attempt or even in fifth attempt. How do they do it? It's a big question, right? People have special sessions on that how to motivate yourself. Why? Because those people could, you know, manage their own and regulate their own emotions. That is why. We will discuss in detail all this when the chapter on AI comes, but I'm just telling you because if I tell you just a diagram and just show to you, it's not going to make any difference in your knowledge. You'll just see, padhaya, and then you'll move forward. Okay, by this way, maybe you'll be more aware about AI, and you know, just when you wake up tomorrow, you will be, you know, amazed that you remember something. All right, so when you manage your emotions, you can become adaptable. Like there is sudden posting, okay, there are riots. During all these, you are adaptable. Basically, you will be able to turn negative things into positive or stay positive during a negative thing going on in your life. Okay, quickly moving forward to the next part. Management of social emotions. Okay, what is the benefit of this? If you can motivate yourself, link with this, you can motivate others, you can influence others, right? So this is how basically you can become a good, any guesses, leader. So people who are able to influence better become better leaders. But that doesn't mean this is always a positive thing, because we all know about Hitler. Okay, so this is how it is all related. Okay, so although it seems quite a bit long, but in examination, once you learn how it gets produced, you know, you will just have to remember a mnemonic. Okay, so basically, So basically, once you know how it is created, like I just explained you, okay, I also remembered only four things, okay, social awareness and self-awareness and recognize and regulate. Okay, after that, I have also made a chart in my mind, okay, that this thing flows from this thing and all that. The way I made it, you also try to learn. Okay, so this is how we interlink. Okay, so all this leads to what? Emotional and intellectual growth of a person. Okay, you become more mature. You have wisdom. And please remember wisdom, we'll discuss it later. All right. Okay, so let's move forward. Now we come to the second part. So in the first part, you define and you draw the diagram. Okay, in the second part, we will see the importance. Okay, why it is important briefly. Briefly, you will tell in 2 to 3 lines why it is important. Okay, and then we'll also compare it in 2-3 lines with IQ. Because if you do not compare with IQ, it will be, you know, basically something would be missing, because you have to compare, okay, or basically give importance. So you will tell how not just IQ helps in your progress, how emotional quotient or emotional intelligence will also help. So basically, benefit is it provides emotional and intellectual growth, like I just said, right? And it provides you awareness about yourself and social surroundings. So it makes a, basically importance is it makes a civil servant emotionally aware, stable, makes him or her calm, and lays down a path of wisdom. Now, if we compare IQ and EQ. Now, IQ is more beneficial. It has its own value, but it is more beneficial in some, you know, operational procedures. Or basically a routine work or something. All right. But for long-term growth of a person and long-term sustainability, basically better service also, better service delivery, that can be made possible by having a very good emotional intelligence. All right. Because emotional intelligence provides necessary skill to deal with juniors, seniors, media, all right, politicians. Okay, so emotional intelligence is, that is why very important. Okay, let's move forward to the third part, right? Basically, we have to tell the importance of it. So how it is important? Let me tell you the theoretical part and how it can be implemented. I'll tell you this in two parts. So a person, like I told you in the diagram, let's go to the diagram. Okay, who is socially aware, okay, and is touch with people's emotions, that person would be in touch with the ground reality, right? So that person would be able to make better schemes, right? So basically, if you're sitting in Delhi and your whole life you have never served in a village, can you or will you be able to understand the problems a person actually faces in villages? No, right? That is not possible. There is no theory that will tell you that how the person living in villages actually feel. Okay, so this is very much applicable to government schemes, like let's say Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. All right, so if somebody understands the socio-cultural behavior in the country, they can better lead for success of this, success of this scheme. Okay, let's move forward to the next point. Also, if people are aware of socio-economic condition or cultural condition, political condition of India, they can better implement outside schemes in India also. There are many times our administrators and politicians or serving ministers, they are sent outside. Basically, they go to developed countries for best practices. You must have read about that. So if they blindly implement this in India, many things won't work because socio-economical, cultural, political arena in India plays differently. All right. So if somebody understands that, they can customize the scheme which is working somewhere else to India. Okay. So this is the benefit of an intelligent, an emotionally intelligent civil servant. Okay. So let's see another point. If somebody is basically emotionally intelligent, they can communicate better because they know their emotions, they can control them when they are nervous and then perform better. Okay, so this helps where? Okay, this helps when a person is in a, let's say, heading a mob control police force for a while. Okay, so if you are better communication, if you're better at communication, okay, so you can balance different perspectives. Okay, you can be good at crowd management because there, in when people are angry, rationalism doesn't work. Basically, logic doesn't work, emotions work. You have to deal with other people's emotions. Okay, now as I mentioned here, a person would be more adaptable. Okay, how can this help? If person is more adaptable and able to deal with uncertainty, right? If this will help him or her to deal with disasters in the areas they are serving. Okay, so these are few points which you can write. Or another thing, there is if the person is able to handle pressures, okay, they can better deal with everybody else, like the political masters, the bureaucratic masters, media, public in general, okay, and they can be aware of whom to serve, okay, and that is the public. Okay, this is the importance. This is how you link. Okay, now another thing that comes, that if a person, let's say, is aware, okay, of others' emotions, that person, let's say, I have seen this example in real life, people who are working too much, they're not able to take time out for family. Okay, they think things are going well, no problem, I'm earning, things are fine, everybody's okay. But sometimes emotions also are needed, like, apart from money. Okay, so simple act like dropping off children, your children, in the morning to school will create an emotional bond, right? That will make you more aware of their emotions. That will make them a better person. They have somebody to share their emotions with. All right. So kids get alienated very fast. Okay. So this is how basically the application of emotional intelligence. All right. So I know this discussion has gone for a bit longer time, but when you read this, when you understand and make notes, it will come quickly to you. Here I've told you how to think, which many people don't tell. So that is why it is taking a lot of time to tell you. Because once you understand, then you can relate well. All right. So I've also talked about using examples. I have also told you about basically small examples like disaster, right? When you communicate, family thing, okay? These implementing scheme outside, sorry, implementing outside schemes inside India. Okay, here I would like to tell you something which we can, many of us can relate. In Bhagavad Gita, chapter 2, verse 54, there's a term called Sthit Pragya. Okay, Lord Krishna tells this, that the mind which is controlled leads to steadiness of wisdom. Everybody has wisdom, but some have it in a less amount, and some people have it in higher amount. But many times mind is wandering, so you are not able to focus, you are not stable. Okay, this can also be related with sattva, tamas, rajas gun. We'll discuss all this, but I'm just telling you about an example from Mahabharata and Indian philosophy. Okay, so what is the benefit of a stable mind? If you are emotionally stable, how it will benefit you? So if your mind is steady and has wisdom, then you can make better decisions and deal with administrative situations better. Basically, if you see Rajaram Mohan Roy, Mahatma Gandhi, Alex Paul Manin, who was kidnapped by Maoists, then Indore IAS officer who cleared the garbage, they had to deal with many people, right? They had to deal with a lot of emotions of people. If you're dealing with people, you're basically dealing with emotional beings, right? So this is how the importance is there. Okay, so coming back to the previous slide. So we have discussed all the parts, we have defined things, we have given its importance, we have answered the question, and we have also answered how it helps the civil servants. And we have used examples by relating it with real life, simple examples. Do remember, do not make things complex, because being simple is the real deal. Because examiner knows, if you are not relating things with life, you are munging things up. Okay, and that does not lead to good marks. Now that discussing the answer is over, we shall move on to the case study. All right. So what is the approach that is to be taken in solving or studying about case studies? See, you have to remember that the examiner is checking a lot of answers. Okay. So he or she might get bored. So what to do? You have to be innovative, like this slide only, right? So try to be innovative in the answer. And how you can do that? If you practice innovativeness in the class, okay, or you're taught innovatively, and then you also make your notes innovatively. And you don't have to do a lot of things. What you have to do is relate and make some diagrams, which you can remember, because they do look attractive, right? But again, always remember relevancy. If you will draw a very good, excellent diagram, good looking diagram, but it's not relevant to the answer, you won't get marks. As simple as that. And if you even draw basically a tuta futa answer, pardon me, not tuta futa answer, tuta futa diagram. So if even you make a half baked diagram, that will also fetch you marks. It is if it is relevant. So please remember that. Okay. So many people in case study don't write difficult steps. This I have observed. Okay, because I have worked as an evaluator also for GS copies. So I see that many people don't take the difficult approach. Basically, they don't tell the difficult step. They just try to give you some answer and beat around the bush. Like if there is sometimes there is no choice, and this happens in every 10th case study or 6th case study. Sometimes you don't have a choice except to take the hard step. Okay, I'll give you example. So basically, many people don't take the hard decisions. We tell basically how we'll be careful, but we don't tell that what if all else fails, what then? Okay, we have to also tell that, no, because in life many times what you think will work won't work practically. So basically we have to focus on what works and not on some utopian idea of ethical governance or good governance. So basically, just an example, you are an IPS, you have a gun. Okay, sometimes in life or in career, many people do not even shoot a bullet and just complete their career. That happens. But sometimes you might have to, if you're in such a situation, let's say self-defense, what you will do then? Will you practice empathy, compassion? If the person is coming at you with a weapon, okay, maybe you will not shoot them directly in a deadly manner, but you might fire a warning shot, right? That is how they're trained. They fire a warning shot in the air, right? So basically some people don't like violence at all, and I understand that. But what about self-defense? I'm not asking you to hurt the person, but I'm asking you to warn the person. Okay. So see, this might make some people uncomfortable, and that's the point, because real life is sometimes uncomfortable. And that is my approach in this ethics series also, to make you realize things that happen on the ground. All right. So basically, many people, right, don't write difficult steps, and that is okay. That's their choice. Okay. But I would advise what I just told. So next, there are many times that people don't use effective examples. So we have to use compulsorily administrative orientation and examples. Why? See, ethics is a paper not from the philosophical perspective. You're not doing here MA in philosophy, but it's a test of, you know, ethical tendency and aptitude of the future bureaucrats. That's what UPSC is testing. So here they just want to see how ethically you can act while you deal with the public. All right. So relating to this, let's see in case studies. Okay. In case study, when you write about a thinker, you can write relevant point of a thinker. Okay. Just as all right. So here we see the case study, and we'll approach it the way we have just read. So this was an actual case study which was asked in the examination in the year 2016. So suppose, I think it's a bit too long, but basically the crux is that a woman comes to you and she cannot prove that she is an actual beneficiary of the scheme, and you are the in charge of implementing the scheme. Okay. So I'll pause the video for a second, or I'll pause speaking and you can just read it. Okay. You can pause the video. Okay. And read it for your own benefit. And if you want, you can come up with your own example meanwhile, and I'll discuss the approach and answer with you. So basically there is a dilemma, right? And they are asking how you will resolve it, and they are asking reasons for it. So please remember these two part of the question. Okay. So let's go ahead. You have to first introduce something. And what will you do? You have to briefly tell the case and the dilemmas and the facts. Basically, the case will have some facts and some dilemmas. So fact here is that we have a woman who might be eligible, but does not have proper documents. Okay. Now there are some values here also, like what, or basically dilemmas, duty versus compassion, spirit of service versus following the rules, objectivity versus sensitivity. Okay, here we have to remember a very important point that we don't have to, you know, be so heartless that we exclude someone. Okay, if the person is beneficiary, we have to be very careful so that we don't exclude someone. Okay, all right. So once you see that and write about the dilemmas and the facts, we move forward to the next portion. Here, the question, basically we have read a theory question about emotional intelligence, right? So here I would like to tell you something, that if you are emotionally intelligent, then you will try to control your emotions and then take a fair and objective decision. You know why? It's because, see, it's much more important that we do not exclude a deserving candidate, right, for whom the scheme is meant. Basically, in this case, we see that there is a poor old lady, right, she is poor woman, right, she deserves the care and the support, so, but documents are absent. So what do? We have to make sure that she does get the benefits, because there are many ghost beneficiaries already in the scheme. Not here, but I'm just telling you a general scenario. Alright, so we have to be very careful and very aware of this thing, that at least a person who is eligible should not be excluded. Okay, that is not justice. If we can exclude her somehow, it will lead to justice, and we'll see how we can do that. Alright, so let's see the approaches. If you simply order her to, you know, complete the documentation process, that is not going to help, because if she could do that, she would already do that. Okay, and even if you assign some person on doing this task with her, this would be difficult, because she might not have the proper knowledge. Okay, she might not have the proper authority also. Okay, so basically another approach is, basically, so first approach is not going to work in her favor. You have to remember that. It might work for you, okay, but it won't work for her. If now you can see that if there are any discretionary powers in the implementation of the scheme, so maybe you can include her, okay, but let us be fair. If that was the question, if that was the situation, the question would not have been asked, right? So what do we do? One option is to approach the seniors and ask their opinion, hai na? So what do we do, Radovid? So now simultaneously, now you can approach the senior also and ask a positive recommendation, maybe to enroll her immediately pending the completion of her documents. Okay, so, or if this doesn't work out, you can at least ask that, you know, seniors for option, that what can I do, because in the end you are implementing the scheme. Okay, you are responsible. See, right here I'm not giving you a model answer, I'm just discussing it with you. These are my approaches. Okay, but here are two things which can make your answer stand out. Again, people will think this, but what will you do that can make things stand out? I thought about this, that in the meantime, I would, you know, take her to an NGO who is helping old age people, or I'll take her to an old age home. Okay? Or there is one other novel idea that you can see if somebody can adopt her for a few days. Okay, but this is all beyond the call of the job. Right, as you can just understand. So what does this show? That you are taking governance from good governance to ethical governance, from basic bureaucratic action to ethical bureaucracy, a genuine empathetic bureaucracy, because you are going out of your way to help her. All right, and also while all this is going on, you have to be with your team, okay, and support them so that they also support her to prove her identity and not basically ignore her case. Okay, so what do we do? So in the meantime, first of all, you get her secure someplace. Okay, and then you can see that her documents are prepared as soon as possible. Okay, these are the normal approaches. But again, I have mentioned earlier that what if nothing works out? What you will do? You can enroll her with an affidavit that considering the need and condition of the lady, it would be cruel and inhuman. These are the keywords mentioned in the answer. It would be cruel and inhuman to not help her. Okay, but you have ascertained her identity. Okay, You have ascertained her identity, and within a given time period, the relevant documents will be submitted, if not immediately. Okay. Now, here you have to justify that it is more important that the steps, it is more important than the steps you are going to take. So what are the reasons that you can possibly give here? If you're not compassionate and empathetic, then a deserving person would not get the benefits. First reason. Okay. And if you follow the rules, then you will become a rigid bureaucracy, right? What you are going to do, you're not going to be empathetic. So the person will just simply blame that, you know, the Babu did not help me. Okay. So basically, what is the use of the means when the ends are not achieved? Like I've told you earlier, means and ends is a debate. Ends is what you aim to achieve. Okay. Means is what will you achieve the ends with, basically. So like if you relate with modern history, means were violent and non-violent, and Gandhiji supported non-violent, Mahatma Gandhi. Okay, end was independence. So I hope it is clear now. Okay, so basically good means are needed. Okay, but if the end is not achieved, then what is the use? So you are not breaking any rule here. You are taking her under the umbrella of the scheme by personal guarantee. Okay. You can also say that under the article DPSP, under the section 4 DPSP of the Constitution, article 41 says that the state has to provide assistance in the case of old age. I am basically paraphrasing the article. So basically these are the reasons. So you do need to help her, but without breaking the rules. All right. So now here come the analysis part. Okay. Which we will also discuss in our case studies. The step of doing something in the meantime. Okay. Like I mentioned here, and the actual step that I told you. Okay. These are all ethical governance. And here you can validate this by saying that my actions are motivated from Gandhiji's talisman and his principle of Antodaya. Okay. As again, I like to mention that note, the question is saying that if you don't help her, it is cruel. It would be cruel and inhuman. So basically you have to read between the lines. Okay. So you have to help her. Okay. That is my opinion. And that is also opinion of many people that I talk to, that you have to, but without breaking the rules. All right. So here I'd like to mention some tips for you. Okay. Which might be beneficial. So here you have to take some extra step. Because if you become fully objective, then she might not get the benefits, right? Now, for something extra, which I have prepared for our viewers, yahan pe you have addressed the symptom till now. Ye bahut important ek tip hai, which I learned after, you know, a lot of case studies, that you are addressing the symptom here, that what was the effect, you are addressing that, okay? Like the effect is not... she doesn't have the documents and she's not getting included in the scheme. This is the effect. The actual cause is not, there is no option of dealing with this problem. I'm not saying that you have to furnish wrong papers or basically jali papers, but there are no options of dealing with people who prima facie, by basically you will do the investigation before obviously giving an affidavit saying that you are including her in the scheme. You have to do your own investigation. Okay. So if prima facie she appears to be a resident of the village and all, so you can say that something might have happened and we are investigating, but she needs to be taken care of in the meantime, because you might not have seen, but there is a lot of problem like this that happens. Okay. So here you have addressed the symptom, but you have to address the cause. That there are many such cases that will be like this. Okay. So the cause is basically no operational SOP, standard operating procedure for such a situation. Okay. And she is also the one of the few people who came to you, but right. But there are many people who might not be able to. So in the end, you have to mention that you will do basically a survey or a drive to create awareness about the program and find out if there are any more cases like this. Okay. So that gives a wholesome approach, that you are addressing what is in front of you, and you are also able to analyze the actual cause and able to find out what is hidden behind the curtain and basically read between the lines. Okay, so this covers our discussion of examples, right? So I hope this was helpful. And moving forward, I'd like to, basically this is a break slide, but I would like to take you to our next section of the presentation, which is why such a session. Okay, usually when people take orientation sessions and they discuss what they are going to offer and all that, but rather than saying it, I believed in showing you. Okay, so that is why we have created such a session where we first introduce you to our method of solving things and method of showing you that what we actually teach, we have already done and it has worked also for many people. Okay, so I hope the discussion was fruitful for you and it helped you in finding where you can improve. And this is an orientation video for our course. So let's start with the why of this session, that why I want to do this. So basically we want to give you a glimpse of how our teaching orientation is, which I just mentioned. Okay, so we want to give you a basically a trailer. Okay, on how we are going to actually teach. Okay, so after this, let's now move on to our offering of ethics to you. Like what would be the course structure and what is our approach towards ethics, okay, as a course. Right now we just saw that how we will teach you the questions. Okay, all right, so let's begin with the nature of the paper. As we have observed in this paper, UPSC wants that you need to be more thoughtful than rather than memorizing. Why? You might have seen a question on happiness that stumped everybody. Wo sawal se sab chong gaye the, because there is no ready made answer for this. And if you have not thought about it, what will you do? Nothing, right? You can't, and people thought about it in the exam itself. So if you think about something in the exam, it will obviously take your time. And if it takes time, it will take time from the other questions away. Okay, so you have to think. And that is why I've said to you that after every lecture, please take 5 to 10 minutes to think and relate the chapter with your own life. Okay, next thing, aptitude more than achievement. Why? This is because you have to develop an ethical aptitude toward life. Okay, you will, basically when we teach you something, if you relate with your life, you will start thinking your actions in ethical perspective. So that will develop an aptitude. Okay, and this will not be done in a day. It will take at least 1 or 2 months. Okay, so achievement, by achievement here, I mean that you don't have to complete 2 books or 3 books. Okay, and basically do definitions and mug them up. No, you have to develop a perspective which will come from thinking. Okay, so basically on the left hand side, I have told you what to do. Okay, coming to the third point, future and past. Why this I have written? Because I've observed the UPSC papers and what they ask is your problem solving technique. And they need to know that, because you're going to do that. If you're selected, you are going to do that in the future, right? In the past, people tend to basically learn. In the future, they apply. So UPSC is focusing on this. They will ask you what you have studied, but they will also ask you how can you relate it, or what does it mean in public administration. There are many questions on which concepts are asked. Okay, or thinker's quote is asked, and they straight away ask you to how it will affect the administration, or what is the use of this value in the administration. Okay, excuse the spelling, these are just short forms. Next point is, the UPSC demands a well-formed mind, not a well-informed mind. That is, you need to have the knowledge, but you need to be able to apply. And all these three things will lead to a well-formed mind. See, in exam, you have to remember there is a time crunch, which I've told you before. And ethics paper is already lengthy. Okay, so if you want to be fast, you need to develop a perspective. Bas, remember this rule. That's it. So basically, if you draw a Venn diagram, okay, this thing will lead to better perspective. if you do this thing, thinking, you have developed an aptitude, you think about application of stuff and not just mugging them. Okay, all right. Another point which I've observed that if you relate things with your life, okay, once you start observing, you start thinking, okay, how can I improve my ethical aptitude? How I can make my decisions more ethical? Okay, if you even read about the previous year questions after completing the syllabus, we will discuss these questions, by the way, in our course. If you think about them, you will then also develop a ethical aptitude. Okay, why all this? Because this all will lead to application in the exam, and that is our final aim. So there is a process, okay, by which you do things, and that leads to better marks. And these all are basically derived from experience of many people. All right. Okay. So what would be the role, my role as a mentor in your preparation? This thing or this prism, okay, this I have to develop in you. This is my aim. Okay. Knowledge from GS 1, 2, 3, optional. Okay. General reading, daily observation, which we wrote above. Observation. Okay. See how things are linked in our own presentation. That is how ethics are linked, and that is how we teach, by linking things. Okay. Because to be frank, how much will you remember? No. Kitna yaad rakhoge? Okay. Fir aage chalte hain media pe. Media means not just TV media, basically not just news media. It means newspaper also. Okay. It means movies also. Like Pink, Dangal. Okay, it means a song also. So basically collecting examples from all this. Okay, and not for examination, just observing. Okay, daily observation leads to, like, basically you interact with people. Okay, go talking to a sabjiwala, talking about their problems. Okay, how they source their material. I just chat people up and ask them that what issues they face. I talk to many people during COVID time, many people who were owning industries, and I talk to many people who are owning their own businesses, small businesses, big businesses. Okay, so this is all daily observation. Okay, then knowledge from GS, that has to go through this prism, and I'll tell you what later. I'll tell you later what is in this prism. So this leads to wisdom, development of wisdom. All these three things, when they go through this prism, lead to wisdom, and that leads to marks. Okay. All right. So we'll discuss about the prism later, which is right now. Anyways, so not the twist I expected. Anyways, so the philosophy part of the syllabus, there are three, according to my own observation, there are three parts of the syllabus: philosophy, psychology, public administration. In philosophy, we have unit 1+5. Unit 1 is basically ethics and human interface, right? In it, we'll learn about all about ethics, morals, private and public relations, human values. We'll learn about role of family and so on. Fifth unit is related to this, which is contribution of moral thinkers and philosophers from India and the world. Okay, coming to the psychology part of the triangle, it is unit 2, 3, and 4. Unit 2 is our attitude. We'll read about how to, you know, read about content of it, its structure, its function. Then we'll read about different type of attitudes. Then we'll see how to persuade people and all. Okay. Next thing is unit 3 is aptitude for civil services and foundation values. Okay. Next fourth unit is emotional intelligence, and we saw how important it is, right? Okay. So in public administration, now unit remains 6+7. Which is sixth unit is civil services values and ethics in public administration. Okay, what are the problems? What are the sources of ethical guidance? Basically, what is accountability? What are moral values in governance? Ethical issues in international relations. All right. Seventh unit is probity in governance. In that, we will see a lot of applications, basically information sharing, RTI, okay, code of ethics, code of conduct, basically. Right, quality of service delivery and challenges of corruption. And after, in the end, we'll see case studies. So So this is how I've restructured the syllabus. How it will help you is, although we will go unit by unit, but how this will help you is, if you analyze any topic, let's say you analyze greed, okay? So when you relate anything with GS 1, 2, 3 or optional, you pick the topic and you make three sections: philosophical, psychological, and public administration. So basically, if you see philosophically, there are many thinkers who have discussed on greed. One famous quote comes to mind of Mahatma Gandhi, wherein he said that there is enough for every person's need and not greed. Okay, so you can see that many people have talked about it and you can learn about their thoughts, and we will also teach you. In psychology, you can see that that behavior leads to amassing wealth by any means necessary, right? And people don't give to other people, right? In public administration, it leads to corruption. So this is just a simple example which just came into my mind right now. So this is how you can distribute the syllabus, okay? And analyze any topic that is there in the newspaper or in your own life. All right. Okay. So coming to our own module, okay, what are the highlights? We will focus on clearing your concepts, okay? We will focus that you understand concepts with examples. We will not give you a bookish definition. We will try to give you a definition which is in a simple language and with enough examples that you can relate with it. Topics will be covered, whole units will be covered. We will especially have case study sessions, you know, and we will have at least one answer per session, one question and answer per session, okay? Then we'll interconnect with all GS papers like history, GS1, GS2 and so on. We'll give you examples with that. This is our special thing. We'll provide you tools and templates. Basically like the triangle which I just mentioned, okay? And there are some samples in the coming slides also. So we'll tell you how to make a diagram, okay? See, when I'll teach you by creating various diagrams like one relate to two, relate to three, and I've used them in my slides also right now in this session. So you can see the approach that I've taken, okay? So we will provide you tools and templates so that you can quickly attempt the question, okay, when it comes to you. Like we'll give you some intros, basic intros which you can use, okay? We'll provide you some basic conclusions and we'll provide you chapter wise examples. All right. So case study, we'll have separate sessions on case study, answer writing. There will be a question daily, you know, I'll tell you the question, then next day I'll discuss the solution. Okay. To the point notes and examples, we'll have these short points, which you can basically, what we are trying to do is we are trying to help people who are working and the people who are first time attempting this. So both will be benefited from the way we are teaching. It's very interactive. It's very colorful. It's very full of, you know, diagrams and teaching aids. So how that will help you is that since we are a visual learner, okay, you will see that image and it will, you know, be imprinted on your mind. And when you go into the exam and you relate it with the syllabus, because like I said, we'll give you syllabus wise, chapter wise examples. So when we give those notes to you, they will be chapter wise, right? So you will be able to relate. Okay. We will have a special lecture, a full lecture, okay, on ARC report, okay, wherein we'll tell you the important quotes. I'll have an example of that in the further slides. We will be dealing with previous year questions section wise. I'll give you, let's say, brief outline of an answer, okay, of every previous year question, okay, in the course. Samples of things to come, which will basically the notes which I have made already, okay, and the notes of ARC, like this one, okay? There are some quotes and how the definition of corruption basically from second ARC. Then these are the diagrams, sample diagrams, which you will get. I will be creating them and you can just take a screenshot, insert them into your notes, you know? All right. This is one diagram which I would like to explain you that in time crunch, okay? See, while I checked a lot of copies, I learned a lot from them also. You know, people, when they had time crunch, they used to just draw a diagram and leave it. So many times in exam, there is a time crunch. What can you do in that time? I'll show you an example. See, there was a question that how transparency can lead to good governance. So this person, what they did, they made a simple flowchart. Okay, so they said that public trust would increase, corruption would decrease, and they have not even used complete grammar. They have just read corruption decreases. Okay, optimal utilization of resources, probity ensured, effective and efficient public service delivery. Okay, so basically they have listed out the benefits of transparency, and then they have just drawn an arrow and said that this will all lead to good governance. So this is very rough. I understand that this is very simple also. And there you can say that, no, I will not give full marks, but you have to appreciate the effort. The person tried to make something on the spot in a time crunch. Why? Because they have learned it this way. And I'm pretty sure they have their notes in this way also. Okay. So this is our approach, that we are going to tell you, okay, how to attempt things. Okay. We are going to give you examples. We are going to give you notes. We are going to discuss previous year questions. We are going to give you, we are going to have special sessions on case studies. We'll be having daily answer writing. Basically, we'll be providing a question as a homework, and then you can attempt it at home, and we'll discuss it on the next lecture. All right. So just to summarize, we have seen a theory answer approach. Okay. We have seen a case study approach. All right. We have seen why this session was conducted in this way. We have seen the nature of the paper and my understanding of it. We have seen how I'm going to explain you to develop an ethical, basically an angle of looking at things. Okay. We have discussed how a syllabus is restructured. Okay. And how you can link it with another topic. We have given you the module highlights. Then we have shown you some samples, right? You have seen it. All right, folks, this is all for this video. This is our orientation video. All right. By the way, I would like to wish all the best to all the aspirants for their preliminary examination results. If you make it, then very good. And if you don't, then also very good. You know why? Because this is the right time to start preparing for next year. And then you can also patiently work on yourself by working smartly. By working smartly, I mean you can do a SWOT analysis on yourself by analyzing your strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. Okay, you can see that where you are strong, where you are weak. Okay, what you can utilize now. Basically, you have time before next year, and what threats are there? Basically, are you demotivated not to prepare? So basically, you can do this, and you can start preparing for next year as soon as possible. Take time, no worries, but get back and on that horse, you know. And defeat this. Okay, don't get defeated. All right, so I hope with this analysis you will be better equipped, you know, to handle the preparation going forward. All right, with that out of the way, I bid you all goodbye for now. Hopefully we will meet in the ethics course, right? And thanks a lot everyone for listening. All right, bye bye.